Hello, you're watching Proactive London. Joining me today is Malcolm Palle. He's the executive chairman of Coinsilium Group. Malcolm, tell us what's happened with Bitcoin after hitting that all-time high earlier this year. It seems to be range-bound in that kind of $65,000 to $70,000 range.
Yeah. Well, let's jump straight into that because that's really, that sets the scene for everything that we do with our business because it's all about sentiment. And it is a sort of it's an interesting time, Stephen, but it's my take is from looking at all the analysis around is that we're kind of living in the aftermath of the halving, which is, you know, there was a lot of excitement going into it. And, you know, the natural thing to think is that there's half as many Bitcoin that are going to be up for rewards after that halving event goes from 6.25 Bitcoin per block down to 3.125 or 900 a day down to 450. So there's going to be, you know, it's a real, it has a real impact on the scarcity of Bitcoin and the supply demand fundamentals. So the natural kind of assumption is the price has got to go up because there'll be less Bitcoin available in the stock to flow, you know, model. However, it doesn't play out. It does play out that way in the long term. But in the short term, what actually happens, and this is, I think, we're seeing evidence and people are referring to it at this stage as the miner, as in miners, Bitcoin miners capitulation, which is really a competitive thing because Bitcoin miners, a lot of pretty much anyone with the processing power can set up as a miner. But in order to actually increase your odds of actually getting the rewards, which is what the miners are in the business for, and every block that's completed, the fees for that block and the block reward, which is now 3.125 Bitcoin, goes to the first miner that solves the puzzle for that block, and everyone else gets nothing. So it isn't, it's a numbers game, a little bit like, you know, if you do premium bonds, the more you've got, the more chance you've got of winning. So the more processing power you've got. So people and miners tend to work in pools or they have to be very, very large entities. And with this event, with the halving, we're entering this period where there's a squeeze on the less efficient miners, which has been brought about by the ones with the scale. Now, historically, the average duration, according to Crypto Slate, which follow quite closely and would urge your viewers to look at as well, it's a very they've got good analysis there. They said that, you know, historically, the average duration for a this crypto miners capitulation is about 41 days. And as of a couple of days ago, we were 33 days into it. So it sort of carries on because everyone who's mining is effectively, even at these prices, because there's half the amount of Bitcoin around, the sub-economic, as in, you know, they'd have to sell their reserves. Some of them, if they're not making the profits on the actual, you know, the mining and the fees, they're going to have to dig into their reserves, and that's what is sort of holding back the price. A lot of people are selling just to keep going. So although it's loss making, they're looking sort of further forward. Say, can we afford? Have we got enough stock of Bitcoin or crypto to sell so that we can keep in business until the market conditions improve? So you know, that's what's really happening, and I'm not sure we're at the end of it or near the end of it. I think it might be quite a long cycle because the other dynamic that we have, which we didn't have before, is there's quite a bit of demand from the certainly since the launch of the ETFs. But of course, demand is impacted by price. So some people will look at this and say, well, you know, why should I buy now if the price is going to go down? I might be able to buy later. But this is all part of that cycle, and that's the psychology at this point in the cycle. My view is it might go on for the summer. It might, you know, there could be something else that comes along which is quite dynamic and pushes the price up. It might have a minor capitulation in the meantime, but what tends to happen if it capitulates, and we've seen this a couple of months ago, it gets to a point where people buy, and because the long-term picture is so bullish, I suspect that the capitulation won't be that deep, but it might be needed just to clean out the market.
So, looking beyond the halving events, Malcolm, which could work itself out, how else are you seeing, which other fundamentals are affecting the market? We've got the US monetary policy at this stage, but we also have that institutional demand that you talked about, particularly due to the growth in the ETF market.
Well, that probably is going to be more interesting for other cryptos that are going to have ETFs created around them, like Ether, and there's even talk of Solana. And that sort of opens up the door to lots of others. But the highest quality ETF, really, which those with the experience and understanding will go for, will be Bitcoin. And that will, I think, there's still lots of entities, certainly institutions, haven't got enough exposure to it. There's a greater understanding now. That knowledge is growing all the time. So that demand will hum away, in the background, whilst this noise is going on in the foreground with the market action. And you are seeing, quite aggressive resistance at the 70,000 mark. For quite a while, but it won't, it's not like that resistance is terminal. It will go on for as long as it goes on for, and then at some point it'll just it break through, and then there'll be, as with all markets, too many people on one side of the boat, like the shorts, think, okay, this is, yeah, we better get out of here. They'll cover, and then it will spike it up, and it's done that time and time again. I think the other interesting thing is that, when Bitcoin catches a cold, the rest of the cryptos, get pneumonia or whatever, but or one sneezes, the other to catch pneumonia or a flu. And that's what we're seeing playing out as well. And it's also impacting a lot of the newer projects that are waiting to launch, because they just really want optimal conditions, and those optimal conditions are not predictable. I don't think, I think we're at a stage in the market where we're well over the worst, because you look at the price rise from beginning of 2023 to where we are now. Bitcoin's up nearly, well, four times almost. And so that means that we've passed the bear market stage, and we just need to break through that previous all-time high, which has been tested and just broken through a bit, and you need to blast through that. And that is pretty much set in stone from my perspective. It's just not known about the timing. But I think what we'll find as well is that once Bitcoin gets to that point, the alts, all the other tokens, are going to start, motoring, like on steroids. So I can't pin down to a time, but I know that, judging by previous cycles, we'll see probably the improvements that we need after the summer, towards the end of the summer. And if past kind of performance is anything to go by, indicators are anything to go by, then 2026 should be a bumper year. We're certainly lining up for that, because with our advisory work and everything else we're doing, because you need the conducive conditions, and that's really what has happened in the previous stages of the cycles, but it probably even more so now, with a greater understanding, a little bit more certainty on the regulatory side, if not in sort of regulation pass, certainly the noises coming out of the US. And you talked about the market conditions. A lot of people are expecting increased liquidity in the US markets imminently, and that should have a good that could be the catalyst that we need to see Bitcoin move further forward. So short term, very short term, we're kind of, it's raining out, and we're just sitting waiting for the storm to pass. Medium term, we're optimistic. Long term, we're very optimistic.
Well, let's hope that summer cold is short-lived for Bitcoin and the other crypto. Malcolm, thanks as always for your insights.
Pleasure. Thanks very much, Dean.
That's Malcolm Palle. He's Executive Chairman of Coinsilium Group.